sing this morning. Let's sing America the Beautiful. Father, we come to you this morning. We just say thank you. Thank you for the love of Christ that passes all understanding. Thank you for your word that we can glean from at any moment, any time. Thank you for your spirit that draws us and calls us. And Father God, most of all, thank you for the love that so many times, as we realize even this morning, we're so undeserving of. But while we were yet sinners, you commanded your love toward us. So, Father God, we just ask you to be in our service today. Father, we just thank you for this opportunity to be in this place. We thank you for those that have come into this fellowship this morning to hear from you this morning. So, Father, let our words of worship be praised to your ears. Let your words of instruction be a light into our path. These things we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Greet those who are in service, would you?
Good morning. Everybody doing well? Everybody alive out there? Okay, good. Well, wake you up a little bit and make sure that you know that we have a fifth Sunday dinner today. It is a kind of a weekend of dinners, I guess. We have Memorial Day and all these other things going on. So another dinner that you can stay for today. Even if you didn't remember or didn't remember to bring something or didn't get to bring something, we want to ask you to stay. That we normally have plenty of food. We'd love for you to stick around and stay with us. And now these dinners, it's great that we get to eat. It's great that we get to sit down and have lunch. But it's also about some fellowship and kind of getting to know families. That's really the ultimate goal, in my opinion. Well, maybe the food is pretty good, I guess. But but we really do want to have time, because sometimes on Sunday, what happens is we come in, we worship, and we walk out, and we don't really get to know you. So we want to make sure that we have this opportunity. So please stay with us today. We'd like to invite you to do that. By the way, my name is Ryan Tischer, and I'm the youth and associate pastor here. And if you have questions about anything, I'd love to get to know you and give you that information. We had quite the week. The youth, we went to Memphis on Wednesday to have lunch and some fellowship. That food thing, it kind of drives you, you know, so I don't know. That's not good. But anyway, so we did get to go down. We went to a barbecue place, of course, and had a great time. Also went to the pyramid, the Bass Pro Pyramid there. And we enjoyed ourselves and had a lot of great time on the bus. And many kids were thankful that they got to leave. It was kind of the summer celebration. We were thinking about trying to go on a float trip, but with all the rain and everything, kind of messed that up. So, but anyway, we had an amazing trip, and God blessed us. We got back home and didn't have any troubles at all. So just grateful for that. Also coming up real soon is Bates Creek. Make sure you're signing up for that. And if you have other interests for other weeks besides youth, make sure you let me know. We're running up on deadlines for those things. But this Wednesday is one of our first deadlines for the youth paperwork, so that we get you plugged in to Bates Creek. That's our summer camp that we go to each and every year, and it's an awesome opportunity for our kiddos. If you want to be a part of that, if you want to pray for us, we would welcome that. If you put it on your list, write it on the back of your phone, or whatever you have to do to pray for this. This is a great time for kids to be unplugged and drawing closer to God each and every day. so thank you for that. Also, Submerged, our vacation Bible school, is right around the corner. That is right at about a week away. That slipped up on me, because I don't really think about June yet. I'm still stuck in May, but June is Wednesday, right? So next Monday will be the beginning of our vacation Bible school. We're looking forward to that. We're going to have four nights of that, 6 to 8 here at church. Hopefully by next weekend, you'll start to see some remnants of what's going to happen. We're going to put a big backdrop on the stage and some other things so that you can kind of see what's going to go on. But encourage the young people that you know in your life, the kiddos, that they need to be here from 6 to 8 next week. Also, like I said, it's kind of from Monday through Thursday. It includes Friday, but Friday we're going to have like a family night down in the fields below the church here. We're going to show a movie at dusk. We have a really large screen. We might have like a drive-in theater type thing where you guys can come and watch a movie with your children, or maybe you just want to show up and watch it. So we'd love to have you come and be a part of that. So anything else? Any other announcements I'm missing? I want to share anything? So we'll have the deacons and ushers come at this time. We'll have the reading of our scripture. And as they're coming, I'm going to tell you a quick story this week. Now, Rollin, my son, is Rollin. That's all I can say. He's he's my boy, and proud of many things that he's accomplished. But he's either black or white. He's hot or cold. Either you catch him in a great mood or not a great mood. And this week he said, you know, we're just driving along. He said, Dad, you know, God is like our king. And he said, in the technologies of this world, the way we think of things, king is at the top. And I said, well, that's probably right. And he said, well, if God is our king, does that make Jesus the prince? And I said, you know what? Jesus is our Prince of Peace. And I was just really thankful to know that his heart was there. And I wanted to share that with you.
Has God ever spoken to you? If you've been saved, he has. But not many of us have been spoken to like Paul was. Paul was discouraged. He's on his way to Rome. He was under arrest by the Roman soldiers. And he said, then at night following, the Lord stood by me and said, be of good cheer, Paul, for as thou hast testified in me in Jerusalem, so shalt thou bear witness to me in Rome. An audible message to Paul. You may never have the Lord speak to you audibly, but I hope he speaks to you otherwise. Thank you, Lord, for your precious word and for the experience of men like Paul who stood before you faithful and obedient. We just pray, Lord, that we'll be amidst of great people here that will stand before you also faithful and obedient to you. We pray, Lord, for this very service here today. We pray for Brother Rogers. He comes. Lord, that you speak to him and through him and speak to our hearts this morning from the message that you have for us. Thank you, Lord, for being good to us. Thank you, Lord, for the offering that's being taken. We pray that each one who gives will be blessed by you because of it, because you promised that you would. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Let's stay standing. We're going to do a God Bless America. If you don't mind putting the words on the screen, guys.
Good morning. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, turn with me to the book of John, chapter 8. John, chapter 8. We finished up last week in 2 Timothy. I enjoyed preaching through that, gleaned a lot from it, and so I hope you did also. And so we're going to probably start I've got a few sermons I'm going to preach out of the book of Joshua coming up here in a couple weeks. And so anyway, you begin to pray for that. And as I want to show you a few things that God has opened my eyes to in that. Thank you for the songs this morning. And thank you to those who decorated the auditorium and the flags that we see out today. So much appreciated. And so anyway, and as we celebrate this Memorial Day weekend, and Memorial Day, you know, the last Monday of the month of May, and sometimes people say, well, that's the beginning of summer, which I guess it is, and everything at the lake opens on that day, but there's so much more. And I'm not the history person that so many of you are, and but I read, was reading last night just on the history of Memorial Day, and different than the Veterans Day, but Memorial Day, when we just give thanks and remember those that paid the ultimate sacrifice that we could have the freedoms that we had. And you know, and I read some of the numbers. You know, you think about that, over 600,000 in the Civil War, over 400,000 in World War II, over 100,000 in World War I, and then almost 50,000 in Vietnam and Korea, and even the conflict that we're in now, the battle we're in Afghanistan now, we're 5,000. And it just humbles you to think of those numbers and the people that were willing to, the men and women that were willing to lay down their lives that we could have freedom and have the freedoms that we have today. And we don't even think much about freedom, do we? You know, it's just something that it's kind of like an icebox. You know, and you think, well, what's that got to do with anything? My mother-in-law told me a story one time that when she and my father-in-law first married, that they didn't have an icebox in the house. And so they had a spring house, and that spring house was between a quarter and a half mile away from the house. And so she would have to get up before daylight and walk to the spring house and get everything out and bring it so that she could prepare breakfast. And she talked about the ice box, and boy, when you got an ice box in the house, what that was. And I get up in the morning, I go to the ice box, don't think a thing about it. How many times do we come and stand behind this pulpit and don't think a thing about it, that we have the freedoms that we have? So we thank you this morning for those, and I just hope that through this weekend, and it's a busy weekend, The weather's turned and everything's a little bit nicer. My wife, she domesticated me yesterday. The kids all left and went out of town, and so it was her and I. And she asked me, she said, well, can we go to Buckeyes and get some weed killer? So that was at noon. On the way to Buckeyes, she said, well, I got one stop I need to make at Kohl's and Arnold. So we went to Kohl's and Arnold, and then we went to Buckeyes, and then we went to Schnucks, and found out the next thing you know, at 5:30, I said, you got me today. And she says, well, once we get the grass mowed. And so anyway, so we had a busy and an eventful day, but I think tomorrow we're going to get to take a little bit of time off. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, the book of John in chapter 8. And what I want to share with you this morning is simply this. Do you realize what sin is doing in your life? You know, sometimes the thing is many a times it's this. Our first thought goes to this is with the sin in our lives. It's, well, you know what? And it's what we get away with. You know, I've got sin in my life, but does sin really affect me? You know, is it really the sin, you know? And let's think about it this way, you know. If I just, in my life, if the my life does not hurt or harm anyone else, then you know what? Then sin is really not having a real effect in what's going on in my life. Jesus began to share with the Jews that were there, and he said, I want you to understand something. I want you to understand that sin has put you in bondage and has chained you. Has put you in bond and chained you. In the last few weeks, as we've been studying through the book of Timothy and 2 Timothy there, and Paul, and we've been also going through it in our Sunday school class, our Bible study on Sunday morning, and I just want to say thank you again to those that were part of the Connect class and have been so faithful this last month, and we've just had a great time, and I appreciate their openness and their heart. But we've been studying also through about the Apostle Paul there, and when Paul stood before Agrippa, and Paul made a comment there, and he said, Agrippa, not only that you, but everyone else would be like me except for these chains. Paul made a reference, if you look in the book of Philippians there, and he talked about the chains that he had him in Philippians chapter 1 and verse 11. He talked about the chains that was on him there and how that he used those chains for the power of the gospel and gave him opportunity for the gospel to be shared. If you look in the book of Romans, when Paul spoke in Romans chapter 7, he said, it's not I, but it's the sin that lives within me. It's not the things that I want to do, but the sin that reigns within me. What we find is the effect of sin. One thing that I have never known, and one thing that you have never known, is you have never known of a sin-free world. We live in sin every day. We don't realize many a times the effect that sin has on us. And the thing that you see is the way that it takes us and the road that it takes us down. Jesus there, when he comes onto the scene, Jesus has been, as he's speaking to the Jews there, and the Jews are all about the law. But Jesus comes up and he makes a statement in John chapter 8 that is just I think, one of the most profound statements in the Scripture. In the book of John chapter 8 and verse 36, he says, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. Verse 31, then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth will what? The truth will make you free. They answered him, we are Abraham's descendants and have never been in bondage to anyone. How can you say we will be made free? Jesus answered them, most assuredly I say to you, whomever commits sin is a slave of sin. And a slave does not abide in the house forever, but a son abides forever. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. Friend, I want to share something with you today. Today, you can leave freed from sin. Today, you can leave and the chains can be dropped off. But we think to ourselves there, when Jesus comes and Jesus gives this message, they said to him, we are of the descendants of Abraham. We have never been in bondage. Friend, the thing that we see is today is simply this is that many of us today find ourselves in bondage and we don't even know it. We don't even know it. You know, the thing is, as my old pastor, Brother Byron, used to say time and time again, there's people that's lost that don't even have a clue that they're lost. But the thing is, as he said there, the truth is what sets us free. The truth is what sets us free. What is the truth? What is the truth? You say, well, the truth, we've talked about that in the book of Timothy, but the truth is this: all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's the truth. The truth is, there's none righteous, no, not one. That's the truth. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, his Son. That's the truth. And Jesus came bearing that truth. The book of Romans that we shared this morning, chapter 5 and verse 8, says that God demonstrated his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's the truth. Christ did not just die for the guiltless, Christ died for the guilty. That's the truth. And Jesus said there is a truth there today, and this truth is there, and this truth is what's going to set you free. Free. Free from what? Free from the guilt of sin. Jesus talked about a freedom there that they had never experienced. And friend, today someone would ask me this, Pastor, what's the difference in before you got saved and now? And the thing is, simply this is, and you say, well, you're no longer a sinner. But the book of 1 John chapter 1 and verse 8 says this: if you say you have not sinned, then you're a liar and the truth is not in you. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I'm still a sinner. Paul talked about that in Romans. He said, my spirit, my flesh fight every day. So where does the freedom come from? The freedom comes there that my sins are under the blood and forgiven. And Jesus was bringing this truth and talking about this freedom. It says there in the book of Romans, in the book of John, but he said there that if you shall know the truth, it'll make you free. Do you desire to be free? Do you desire to be free? There's so many people that I talk to, and when I talk to them and they speak to me and they tell me of the conflict that's in their life and battles that they battle with, and they battle them and battle and battle them. And you know, there's so many times that there's people that all the time that that I've been here at First Baptist Church, and the thing is this, and don't take this wrong, but some of you are battling the same battles that you were battling 20 years ago. And the thing is, and my question is simply this, when are you going to come to a point and say, you know what, I just want to be freed. I want to be loosed. I want to know the truth, and I want the truth to give me freedom. See, the thing that what we do is many a times is simply this is, we're like Betty Crocker Christians. I have no idea where I'm going with this, but you hang on, I'm going to bring this back. But the Betty Crocker Christians is simply this: open the box, pour water in it, stir it a little bit, and the thing is, in 20 minutes, open it up and you got the cake. And you said, Pastor, that's not the way that it works. There's more to it. You got to read the instructions on the box. And friend, I'm here to tell you today, this is going somewhere. I'm here to tell you today, it's just not about walking into a church, listening to a sermon, getting dunked in the water, and just simply say there, in 20 minutes, everything's going to be all right. Friend, to really experience the freedom of Christ, it says there, if you're my disciples, do what I say. And Jesus said that there is freedom in truth. Freedom in truth. I'm glad that somebody told me the truth. Somebody told me the truth. There is people out there today that will tell you anything that you want to hear. We've talked about that in Timothy's writings. Remember there when Paul told Timothy, he said in the last days, men will have itching ears seeking the things for people to tell them what they want to hear. There's people out there, but I'm going to tell you something. The truth is true. You say, boy, that's deep. But the truth is true. Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse 6, I am the way and I am the what? I am the truth. Jesus said there, you can just look at me and I am the truth. I am the true way. But what we find out here today is everybody's got a different way. Everybody's got a different way. Oh, surely there's a different way than Jesus. Jesus did not say there, you know what? I am a way. You know what? You know, if you want to find a truth, but Jesus spoke of the truth, and he said the truth will set you free. What you've been battling for many years, today you can settle, and that is claiming the truth and understanding this, that you can't do nothing on your own. Understanding simply this, that without Christ, you know what? You're a defeated individual. Without Christ, Satan can have his way in your life, this way, that way, and any other way. Remember the story I was telling you about the drone a couple weeks ago that I got? I took it out last Sunday. Didn't realize that somebody had been messing with it. And I'd had it down pretty pat. And all you had to do was you just had to put it on smart. What that means is for you that aren't real smart, put it on smart. So I had my plan, man, I had pushed that button and that dude came up. I thought, I'm going to get some good pictures. I'm standing there, and next thing you know, I push for it to go. And baby, that dude took off. It took off, and then it was making a big lap, and I thought, oh man, it is out of control. The only thing I could do is just figuring out how to get to land that thing. Then I found out somebody put it on follow me. I put it on land that thing, and that thing come after me. The next thing I know, I am running around the corner of the building. Praise God, there was nobody there but me. I run around the corner of the building, here that thing flies right past me. Boom, 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 rolls over. My first thing thought is simply this is, you know what? You know, I thought I had it all figured out, and I figured out real quick. I didn't know a whole lot about it. And friend, I want to share something with you this morning. When you think you got it all figured out, a set from the side of Christ, it's time that crash and burn is going to come. The truth is simply this. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the light. There's no freedom outside the person of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. So the next thing that we see is simply this is it says there, Jesus answered them, most assuredly I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave to that sin. A slave to that sin. Think about that slavery, that term. We go back in our Americas and we think about there in the United States, and we go back in the time of the slavery. And when we look at slavery, we think about that, and here these people were, and you know what? They had strength, they had might, but they didn't have what? They didn't have a free will. And the thing that you see is simply this is, think about this. That's what sin does, and Jesus said that. Sin is going to bind you, and it's going to enslave you. The scripture says that through Christ we are more than conquerors. But Jesus said, when you're enslaved, you're bound by that sin. Bound by that sin. Think about today the sin that binds you. Think about the sin that binds you. And you say there, and you say, but Pastor, you know what? I don't really want to go there. Friend, we can go there or we can ignore it. It doesn't make any difference to me. But friend, until you deal with that sin and realize simply this, as I talked to you about in 1 John chapter a while ago, in chapter 1 and verse 9, if we confess that sin, he is able to what? To wash that sin away and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The sin today that enslaves you, by the time you leave here today, you can have freedom from it. And how does that happen? Pastor, you're talking about something that's been going on for a lifetime. Friend, I'm here to tell you, when Jesus died up on that cross, he gave us the freedom. He gave us the power over sin. The last thing, and then I'll close. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. I'm not perfect by no means. I got more flaws than anybody knows. But I know one thing. I'm free. And you said, hi, what do you mean you're free? I'm free of my yesterdays. You know, and you say, Pastor, how do you know that? Because the Psalmist would write it this way. He said, you know what? He parts my sins as far as the east is from the west, and he remembers them no more. I have that freedom. I have a freedom today that, you know what? And in Ephesians in chapter 5, it said this. It said, it's the love of God that passes all understanding. You know what? Even sometimes when I try to explain it, I don't do very well. I don't do very well, because the thing is, I think about that sin that's in my life, and I'm thinking, you know what, how it can control me. But today I have freedom. And it's all because of Jesus. This morning in our Connect class, and I was sharing with them about the plan of salvation, and we went down the Roman road. And in Romans chapter 3, we talked about there's none righteous, no, not one. For the wages of sin is death. We talked about all those things. But then we got to Romans chapter 10. In verse 9 there, and it says, if we confess with our mouth, what? That Jesus Christ is who Jesus Christ says he is, then we can be saved. Saved from what? Saved from our sins. There's none righteous. I could never do it on my own. But today, you can have freedom. You can have freedom. It was there that the Apostle Paul found himself in prison, him and Silas, in the book of Acts chapter 16. And there they were in prison, and it says there that when the earthquake came, it said that their chains fell off. Their chains fell off. And it said they got up and they got ready to leave, and the jailer was there. And the jailer was getting ready to take his own life, and Paul said, don't do that. And he looked at him and he said, sirs, what must I do to be free? He said, no, that doesn't. It says, what must I do to be saved? Friend, I want to tell you something. Salvation and the freedom from sin, the same thing. What must I do? Today, you're here today and you're battling. And you said, Pastor, oh, I got a battle. I got a battle. And that battling, you know what? And it has been something that has just bound me for years. Hebrews said it like this. It says, take off those sins that so easily beset you. The things that bind you, the things that hold you back and hold you down. And when you get that freedom, I've told this time and time again, my dad had an old bird dog and he used to keep it chained up. And he used to keep it chained up and that thing would just run around what it was chained to. But buddy, when he'd go out there and he'd loose that chain, I mean, that dog could run. And friend, I'm going to tell you here, I was in someplace in Texas, I'm trying to remember the name of it, and went down there with a good friend of mine. And the old preacher was up there preaching, and he was preaching a great message on the freedom from sin. And there was an old boy sitting about the second or third row. And about that time when the old boy said, you can be free, that old boy got up, and man, he took off running. He circled that building about two or three times. And all he kept saying, Alan, was, you know what he said? I'm free. I'm free. And you know what? This morning, you can have freedom. You can have freedom. You remember in the beginning we talked about those that paid the ultimate price, that we can have the freedoms that we enjoy today? Well, friend, because Jesus paid the ultimate price, and John said this, and he penned this after Jesus spoke this, and he said, no greater love hath no man than a man that will lay down his life for his friends. Jesus laid down his life that you could have freedom. Today you can have freedom. You can have salvation through the person of Jesus Christ. Stand with me, please. Father God, we come to you this morning. We thank you for the message. We thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you for the freedom that can only come through the person of Jesus Christ. Father God, I pray for that one today that finds themselves in chain and bondage by sin. And Father God, we find that you know that through ourselves the hole just gets deeper. But at the foot of the cross, it all changes. Because of the blood of Christ, we can have victory today. Your word tells us that we're not to be defeated, but we're the more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. Father, thank you for that freedom. Thank you for that joy that passes all understanding. Thank you for that forgiveness. Thank you for the lifting of that weight that ensnares us. Father, most of all, we thank you for the promise that if we confess, that Father, you take it from there. We confess that we're a sinner. We confess that it's all about us. We confess that we tried it all on our own. And we just say, Lord, I just take you. Then we can experience a freedom that we've never known before. He who has the Son is free. He who has the Son is free indeed. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. You come. Father, help us this morning.